never have a albumin right here. Most of the stuff that is filtered out is taken back, because most of the stuff is of use, like glucose, like amino acids, okay? You cannot throw it in urine. And there are some of the stuff that is filtered out, but is still modulated in the blood, and some of that stuff is still secreted into the filtrate. This is a nephron. This is a nephron here. This is the process of filtration. This is the process of reabsorption, taking back all the important stuff back into blood. The blood has like organic acid, uric acid. Uric acid filters right here, but still some amount of uric acid modulated here. So I want to get rid of this uric acid or ammonia. I would also secrete that uric acid and ammonia into the filtrate. So this is called as secretion. Finally, I would be doing excretion. So excretion is the process that is equal to filtration minus reabsorption plus secretion. What we mean to say right here is, the last end that you happen to see is excretion. Excretion is equal to filtration minus reabsorption
plus secretion.
This is the basic renal physiology. This is the basic renal physiology. That every time the blood comes through the afferent arteriole, the plasma filters out, okay? The plasma filters out, and then we have stuff passing down as filtrate right here. This is the nephron, the Bowman's capsule, and then the parts of nephron. What are the parts of nephron? Can anybody tell us?
Proximal tubule, little filling.
Proximal tubule?
Little filling. Yes, that's a tubule. Filling finger.
Arteriole coming, divided into capillary, and Baden and efferent arteriole. This is afferent, and this is efferent. Baden, this efferent arteriole comes down in our coils and then goes up. Okay, so all that stuff can be exchanged with this arteriole coming down. I'm not drawing to just to leave the space for other important stuff to be written right here. Okay, this is the basic anatomy that you get. Afferent and efferent. The process right here is filtration. The process right here that you are going to see is filtration. Process number one. If I constrict the afferent, what would happen to filtration?
Decrease,
because the renal blood flow would decrease. Okay. If I constrict the efferent a bit, the blood flow is same, say 20 milli per minute. If I constrict the efferent for a while, what would happen to filtration?
Decrease.
So there, if I constrict him, The blood is coming at the same pace of 20 milli per minute. So the pressure generated here would be more. So if the filtration would be more. There is increase in hydrostatic pressure, so the filtration would go up. Why I'm saying this? Because in Baden you would be having in this block pharmacology, the drugs that would not to be given because they constrict afferent arteriole and would cause a compromised kidney to go in a renal failure. To increase the filtration process, I can give a drug that only acts on the afferent. It does not touches the efferent. Okay? Say if
constrict the efferent.
Constrict the efferent. So that can increase the filtration. So the first process was about filtration, that is right here. Second process is about reabsorption. So reabsorption starts happening at these cells. Definitely this area right here, this is the Bowman's capsule. This area is your proximal convoluted tubule. This cell that I have drawn is at proximal convoluted tubule. This is descending loop of Henle, this is ascending loop of Henle. Descending loop of Henle and ascending loop of Henle. This is your loop of Henle. Okay. Ascending loop of Henle till here. This is your distal convoluted tubule. And also you would be having cells right here in distal convoluted tubule. Distal convoluted tubule. You would be having cells in distal convoluted tubule. DCT. Okay? DCT. This side is, what is this?
Collecting
duct. Collecting duct. And you also have cells right here. Collecting duct. Cells of collecting duct. As the stuff comes and passes down, okay, most of the sodium starts getting absorbed. Most of the sodium would start getting absorbed. Why? Water is absorbed. Okay, let's begin with before ions, let's go with water. Water is easily absorbed in which part? Proximal convoluted, distal convoluted, ascending, descending, where?
Collecting duct.
Water.
Collecting
This part is totally water permeable. This part is totally water permeable and also permeable to solutes. Okay? But water permeable. This part is totally water impermeable. This part is totally water impermeable. That most of the ascending loop and most of the distal convoluted tubule, most of the ascending loop and most of the distal convoluted tubule is water impermeable. Most of the proximal convoluted tubule and the descending loop is water permeable. There is a third part that is water permeable only in presence of, yes? Only in presence of anybody? There is a third part that is permeable only in presence of ADH. Water permeability depends upon ADH. That part is mojood in the collecting tubule. Later part of the last part of distal convoluted tubule and the collecting tubule. So this sums up how water is dealt in our nephron. simple diagram. Water permeable, most part of PCT and descending. Water impermeable, most part of ascending and distal convoluted tubule. And ADH depends upon how much ADH is mojood, that is, makes water permeability. If ADH is there, it is water permeable. If no ADH is there, it is not water permeable. So that is the idea, right? Yes. What else do you see into this?
Ions are the
opposite. Ions are not the opposite. Which of the ions do you want to get absorbed?
Solid.
Okay, let's just put up these channels and ions so that I can explain it for you. So we come back. This is the nephron, proximal convoluted tubule, descending lobe, ascending lobe, distal convoluted tubule, collecting duct. What you happen to see right here is in proximal convoluted tubule you have, these are basically co-transporters, importers or antiporters, proteins that work only in presence of two ions. Okay? Only in the presence of two ions. But what the most typical thing that we have not labeled right now still is all these cells have got a luminal side towards the filtrate and away from the filtrate, that is the basolateral side, basolateral side. All these cells have got a basolateral side. Yep. All these cells have a basolateral side. What is there so special in the basolateral side for all these cells? What is so special in the basolateral side for all these cells? What is so special in the basolateral side? That it would be taking up most of the sodium, that is free sodium, and would be putting up to potassium. All the cells in the basolateral side of the nephron has got this sodium potassium ATPase pump. So once the filtrate starts coming down, there is kathir amount of water. Water is soluble and permeable, it can get in. What about sodium? Sodium gets into the cell with the help of sodium hydrogen antitransporter or a sodium glucose co-transporter or a sodium chloride co-transporter. So sodium is getting in. This cell would become rich in
sodium.
This cell would become rich in sodium. Now this sodium would be pushed into the circulation through a ATPase, sodium potassium ATPase, and it would push potassium into here. Potassium has got an easily movable channel that can excrete out potassium. Similarly, as the cells are coming down, water is also lost, and water is also getting lost and also getting absorbed in the water is absorbed and also the salts are absorbed. So the filtrate would be coming down, and as it moves up right here is another transporter protein that would pick up sodium, potassium and 2-chloride. Also in the basal cells, you would be having the sodium potassium ATPase. 3 sodium it would put into the blood and 2 potassium would come into the cell. So sodium that is absorbed is put into blood, potassium that is coming as an extra, and chloride would move easily through the chloride channels that we have not drawn in. Okay, the extra, you are getting potassium from HINA also, and you are getting potassium because of this pump also. So this cell becomes very rich in potassium. So right there in the ascending loop, there has to be a very special potassium channel freely permeable for this. So once it is, lot of potassium is going out, this area starts becoming a kind of a bit positive. But in this, the fluid moves up. You have another transporter that is sodium chloride transporter. Over here it was sodium potassium 2-chloride transporter in the loop. Loop of Henle has got sodium potassium 2-chloride transporter, whereas distal convoluted tubule has sodium chloride co-transporter. Okay, same issue. Sodium gets in with the sodium potassium ATPase, it is pushed into blood. Yep. And also chloride can pass easily, so no issues about that. Right here is a calcium, special calcium channel module. What is the role of this calcium channel?
They absorb.
This calcium channel is put up only in response to which hormone? PTH. So still people who are wondering where this PTH is going to act. PTH is going to put up kathir amount of channel in distal convoluted tubule to take up all the calcium. Clear? There is where the calcium would be taken up. So once all the positive ions are getting taken up, right there then the fluid moves further down and you have two very special, not transporters. Transporters are protein. These are two very special channels. One for sodium and one for potassium. You have a pump in a, you are putting out all the sodium into the blood and you are putting all the potassium into the cell. Okay, so the sodium that is coming, will it get absorbed? There is a channel module.
Yes.
This cell is rich in sodium or rich in potassium?
Rich in sodium.
This cell. Because of this pump operating. Rich in potassium. Finally, this cell would become very rich in potassium, because this pump is pushing out all the sodium outside and bringing in all the potassium in. Okay, so once you are throwing out all the sodium, okay, so this cell would be low in sodium. That's why sodium would get in. Same right here. this is putting out all the sodium to the blood, so this cell would be low in sodium, so it would be easily taken up. Right here, this cell is putting up so much of sodium into blood, so this cell is low in sodium. Low in sodium, it has got a transporter protein that would act. That would act because of the secondary active transport. Secondary active transport, and that would act in combination with sodium hydrogen or sodium glucose or sodium chloride. This is the transporter right here that is acting as a transporter as sodium potassium to chloride. This cell, this is a very special cell in collecting tribute. What is that cell name? Yes. It's not this cell.
Collecting cell.
No, collect in the collecting tubule, this is the collecting tubule. You have a cell that is very special. It is called as principal cell, and it is here where it is on this cell where the aldosterone would act. It is this cell where the aldosterone would act. Aldosterone has got salt and water business. What does aldosterone do? Take in sodium and throw away?
Potassium.
Is it doing so?
No.
It will stop the cell.
Come again. Aldosterone, what does aldosterone
stop the cell.
Retention of sodium and water.
Retention of sodium and water. So you are basically, this is going, if you don't take it from here, you will make urine. So you are taking in sodium, along with sodium, a lot of water would be dragged in, and you are throwing away
potassium.
Okay, so this is a principal cell under the effect of aldosterone. This is a principal cell under the effect of aldosterone. Correct? So
what about ADH?
ADH would be acting in the collecting duct, and ADH deals only with
water.
In the
it
same,
only deals with
same place.
In the same place, in the collecting ducts, there are V2 receptors of ADH on the surface, and that would be acting, just making the aqueous channels, and water would be taken in. If there is kathir amount of water, our body needs water. ADH is majud, then only this water would be taken. ADH. This becomes permeable. Otherwise, it is no ADH, mafi permeable to water. ADH majud, shoya ADH majud, shoya permeable to water. That's it. This part, mafi permeable to water. Tayyab? Shoya ADH majud, shoya permeable to water. Kathir ADH majud, kathir permeable to water. That is that.
Aldosterone need ADH?
Aldosterone and ADH are two very different people.
Yes, but they need each. Aldosterone need ADH to absorb.
No,
water.
I mean, so they are not related. They are not interdependent. Aldosterone can act separately. ADH acts separately. They are two different people in two different sharikas in two different job. Got my point?
Yes.
ADH goes through the V2 receptors. Aldosterone goes through the aldosterone receptors. Okay. These V2 receptors are on the surface, aldosterone receptor are majud.
In the cell, on
the surface of the cell, has a cytoplasm, has a nucleus. Cytoplasm is the right guess. On the cell membrane, inside the cytoplasm, inside the nucleus, where is the aldosterone receptor? Cytoplasm is the right answer. Cytoplasm. It is steroid, but none of you are telling me, because these are questions. These are questions that are being tested these days.
Lipid soluble.
Well, you can explain our whole lecture, but the idea is whoever clicks in those 3 hours there, he gets the percentile and he goes to the university, and we always keep on bragging that I was the best in medicine in my college. Hardly matter. You didn't have the score, you didn't go. I'm a bad word, but it goes that way. That is the truth. So why have we just shown you some of the cells, like in proximal convoluted, in loop of Henle, in distal convoluted, okay, and in the collecting tubule, because you would be having also various drugs called as diuretics working in these proper areas, like
loop diuretics.
Loop diuretic, where the loop diuretic will be acting on which cell? Is it this one or this one?
No, on the right.
Which transporter it would block?
Would block
sodium chloride. Potassium 2-chloride transporter. Loop diuretic would act in a. It would block sodium potassium 2-chloride transporter, which is in the loop. Loop diuretic. Thiazide acts where?
In the calcium channel and
thiazide. On the cells module on DCT. Thiazide would stop these. Sodium chloride transporter. Thiazide would stop this sodium chloride transporter. Loop would stop this one. Thiazide would stop this one. Then there are individual drugs acting on all these. Carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, where does it work? So for that you have to know which of these cells would be having carbonic anhydrase. 1, 2, 3 and 4. That is all game about renal physiology. I mean, so you open your box, it is gigabytes. I mean, so some people have shrunk it in, some people have shrunk it there. Guyton has told all of the story. So final outcome is, I'm confused what to read, and final outcome is, moving to the exam and me mafi maloom, which part of nephron absorb water? Which part of nephron is dependent on ADH permeability? Now I'm really in a stiff phase that these basic questions I'm not being able to answer. Are you getting the idea? So, this is how it would be. For carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, you have carbonic anhydrase enzyme in, like you have aldosterone in, principal cells in the collecting tubule, okay? You have PTH receptors in, cells of distal convoluted tubule for calcium, okay? PTH right there. You have carbonic anhydrase enzymes in PCT. It is this cell that is having carbonic anhydrase on the surface. I have not drawn it right here. It is this cell that you will be having carbonic anhydrase enzyme right here. Maybe I will draw it as a triangle. And it has also this triangle inside the, and this is called as, this is an enzyme that is called as carbonic anhydrase. So you have also a drug that would block it. If you block it, definitely there would be problem with the hydrogen excretion and hydrogen elimination. Okay? Carbonic anhydrase.
Isn't the parathyroid hormone
working on all the both sides? No, parathyroid mainly goes with because there are special calcium channels right here. Okay, that can be inserted, and it is here that the calcium is, most of the calcium is absorbed. Divalent ions, magnesium, calcium are taken care not in a in the PCT, not in the loop, it is taken care in DCT and BADE. Divalent ions. Okay, yeah. Any question? Somebody in there?
You said earlier that the parathyroid hormone acts on the calcium channel. Is it parathyroid hormone or vitamin D?
Parathyroid would stimulate those cells to put up. Parathyroid hormone would stimulate the cells in the DCT to make the mRNA, all the nuclear stuff, and then they would put a protein channel that is for calcium, that is right. That is that. So, we have just drawn this diagram for you people to be comfortable, because again, then on this diagram itself, pharmacology people would be coming with a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, put it in a. Loop diuretics, put it in a. Thiazide, put it in a. Correct? That is the idea. That is the idea. So you have to make some chart that is for all of them. Physiology, not anatomy. Anatomy, I am saying it has to be very precise. Not everybody is so good in drawing. But you can make a chart that is okay for your medicine and your physiology and your pharmacology. Like this sort of stuff, so that you revise it easily. Fine, so we just move up, but further on we'll be moving up to the lights. The same stuff has been explained right here. There are substances that would be filtered, okay, and all of them gets into urine. Nothing is reabsorbed and nothing is secreted. Yep. There are substances that would be filtered, but by then some of them would be reabsorbed. Still, soya would be going into urine, but the body would try to reabsorb some of them. There are substances that would be filtered and everything is reabsorbed. Nothing goes to urine. And there are substances that is filtered and also that is only secreted, not reabsorbed, and everything goes into urine. So can you tell out of these four, creatinine, nutrients, electrolyte and organic acid, which is a substance that is filtered and could you take in it?
Nutrients.
Amino acid you do not want to lose. Okay? Amino acid you cannot lose. Any nutrient, vitamins you cannot lose. You will want to take it back, all of them. Right here. Which is the substance that you are filtering and also secreting? That means you want to throw away all of them.
Organic acid.
Which one?
Organic acid.
Like? What do you understand by organic acid? Organic acid but that are made in the body. Okay?
Oh, yeah.
Lactic acid. Okay, lactic acid. That those are called as organic acid. So I would like to get away with the organic acid. There are substances that are filtered and are reabsorbed, but not fully reabsorbed like this, but shoya reabsorbed.
Electrolyte.
There are substances that are filtered and mafi reabsorption and mafi secretion, like creatinine. Not that very important stuff. We let it go. So these are the four stuff and these are the four answers. This one is creatinine, this one is nutrients, this one is electrolytes, and this one is organic acid. By organic acid, we told lactic acid is an organic acid. Having said this, what we have drawn right here is shown right here in the diagram, overview of various chemical handling by different parts of nephron. PCT, descending loop, ascending loop, DCT, collecting duct. All the stuff has been written right here by which of the processes. Secretion is an active process and so is reabsorption. Secretion is always active. If you have to put the stuff back into the filtrate, you would be always using energy. Okay? That's what has been shown in the, some of them have been shown in the red. Active transport is lazim in red in this diagram. So we do not go into much detail of this. We have shown you how the urine is formed by three basic processes: filtration, reabsorption, and secretion. Okay? First thing is that. Second thing is, by then you move out, you can take a click, make a better diagram than myself. I know my diagram skills are not that very good, but still, the idea is you have to catch the idea, not the diagram. The idea is you should be very well oriented about water and should be very well oriented about the sodium. Who maintains the osmolarity?
Sodium.
I know sodium, I'm done. And definitely body is made up of sodium and water. So water is another important stuff that I should know. So for water we have explained for you right here. For rest of the stuff we have explained right here. And by then you can put up from the pharmacology people the drugs that they would be coming. So that's what about the importance of water balance and importance of the osmolarity. We have already talked, not much into this. Is the body able to monitor its water content? Basically, body cannot monitor its water content. Basically, the body monitors its osmolarity. Okay? Mainly the osmolarity. Osmolarity is detected by osmoreceptors majood in the hypothalamus, and there are two types of osmoreceptors, 1 and 2. Osmoreceptor 1 has got a threshold value of 280, and it also causes activation of antidiuretic hormone, whereas osmoreceptor 2 deals with thirst. Osmoreceptor 2 stimulates thirst, osmoreceptor 1 stimulates ADH secretion. ADH has got water business. ADH has got water business. Okay. Whenever the osmolarity is coming down, whenever the osmolarity is increasing, okay, going up, so you would produce antidiuretic hormone, ADH. Okay. Once you produce ADH, there would be water channels put in up, and the water would be taken into the blood. So if I am having a concentrated plasma, the osmolarity is sensed by osmoreceptor in the hypothalamus. If it is stimulated, it would produce ADH. ADH would cause putting up aqueous channels in and taking water into the blood. My blood would become dilute or concentrated? Dilution. And that is how the osmoreceptors have corrected my osmolarity of the plasma. ADH works in the last part of DCT and mainly the collecting tubules. ADH is collecting tubules. Okay? ADH is collecting tubules. That's why we have drawn right here. Collecting tubules. Some books write last part of DCT just to build up a confusion and sell the books. But to be honest, it is mainly the collecting tubules. Most of the books follow collecting tubules. Osmoregulating mechanism is two. Either it is a ADH or it is a thirst. My plasma osmolarity is gone up. My plasma has become more concentrated. Either I produce ADH or I drink direct water. Which one of them is first stimulated?
ADH
is first stimulated. Still it is not being covered, like in days of Ramzan, Baden, Fajr, you don't feel like very thirsty, okay? But Baden, Zuhar and all, still you are losing some free water in case of sweat, in case of urine, okay? And your plasma is becoming more concentrated and more concentrated, and at a particular level, the thirst would be stimulated. Baden. Initially, till Zohar and everything, the kidneys were doing their job with ADH, trying to maintain it. Still, it was not maintained, then we have a stimulated thirst that now you should drink water. And Baden, that is a problem, mushkila in the Ramzan days. We always check time for, okay, when is the maghrib, huh?
Aldosterone
has not to do with, it is one of the mechanism, but aldosterone is not that very good because it is only dealing with the sodium, the salt. Okay? The idea right here is
the water follows the
solid. The water?
Follows the solid.
The water follows the solid, but you don't gain much. You're taking up kathir amount of sodium. My plasma is concentrated. I produce aldosterone. Yep. I produce aldosterone. The rule is take in sodium and with that you get one more water molecule free. So will I be able to correct my osmolarity? Water is coming with that. Free water is coming with sodium. But the lazim is first you take sodium, but then you get water free. So you won't correct your plasma osmolarity by taking in sodium.
Increase
the osmolarity, increase the cell thirst. Correct. Control of ADH. ADH is controlled by two of the mechanisms, like the control of circulatory system. There are secretory cells in hypothalamus that will produce ADH. And how? Whenever there is increase in blood volume, there is increase of arterial blood pressure, both of them can cause baroreceptor changes and this can cause the release of or inhibition of this cell. Once there is decrease in blood pressure, this would cause the stimulation of this cell to produce ADH. One mechanism is by circulatory system, one mechanism is by osmoregulatory system. Whenever my blood pressure is going down due to loss of volume, there are stretch receptors in my heart and also there are stretch receptors or baroreceptors in my arteries. Everybody believe that. Once they are stimulated, will they stimulate the ADH? Yes, they would stimulate the ADH if the blood pressure is down. One action is release of ADH can be done by the circulatory system. Other mechanism is you have osmoreceptors in the hypothalamus that can detect the osmolar changes. That can also stimulate the ADH production. So ADH is governed by the circulatory change, ADH is governed by the osmolarity, both. Not much into this. This is a renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system. Whenever a NAFR is running low on blood pressure, okay, there is a special substance released from the kidney. What is that?
Renin.
Renin has got a special sugar. What is that? Convert. Good. Angiotensin 1. Angiotensin coming from liver to angiotensin 1. This angiotensin 1 then baden
lung.
Goes to the lung, and in the lung which enzyme is modulated?
ACE.
So angiotensin converting enzyme, this would convert it to angiotensin 2. This angiotensin 2 is a master molecule. It would bring up lot many changes. It would stimulate the sympathetics. It would stimulate the ADH secretion. It would stimulate the aldosterone secretion. Right here the idea is not about osmolarity, it is about volume. If the body has to select one, osmolarity and volume. Like I'm running low on volume, okay, but if I stimulate aldosterone, I would increase my osmolarity. So I would correct my volume but increase my osmolarity. So will body do that?
No.
You have to select one, volume or osmolarity. Which one body selects?
Volume.
So even if I increase my osmolarity, I would correct my volume first. Because if you don't correct the volume, there would be circulatory collapse. You do not want that. Okay? So about these ADH secretion and the aldosterone and the stimulation of the sympathetics. So these are few of the things that you have to look into. Thirst, again we have explained the thirst about high plasma osmotic thirst, that is called also called as the osmotic thirst, or hypovolemic. Hypovolemic thirst is once the extracellular fluid falls below 10%. That is because of less volume. But you can have thirst because of high osmolarity even. Okay? So thirst are of two types. Because of low volume, anybody is bleeding, he would feel thirsty because of low volume. Anybody who is fasting and he is getting concentrated plasma as the hours is passing, it is because of the osmolarity. Thirst can be stimulated by both the volume and the osmolarity. It is a body defense mechanism. That's why some people say as a osmotic thirst and a hypovolemic thirst. Okay, that is the what they want to listen. Osmotic thirst is because it detected by the osmoreceptors. Hypovolemic thirst is detected by the baroreceptor. So this is just a remembrance right here. We would just ask you to cover up if you want to take water or something. Just get it for you, because we have only two ions, sodium and potassium. That's it. Okay. But only the key things you have to know about sodium and potassium. So shall we continue with it, or do you need a break of 5 minutes? Continue it. Okay, so everybody, that's what the basic idea about asking is. The basic idea about asking is that everybody is awake or not.
But no questions.
No, I would invite questions at the end, inshallah. Just mark your that slide, okay? I would invite all the questions, no issues. We'll release the badge and I'll answer all your questions. So, we'll be talking about sodium, okay, and potassium disturbances. High sodium and low sodium, high potassium and low potassium. I have not edited the lecture because this is a complete lecture, right from starting from physiology to moving to your medicine. Okay, So I've not edited it. Definitely it has been borrowed from resources for USMLE and all these. So it is bit concise and okay to study. Because these are few of the topics that really complicate the, especially the medical students, from where to study and where to not. First thing, the recommendation should be authentic, very clear. I should believe it, okay? And it should be reciprocated in exam. I can reproduce in exam with that knowledge. These are the two major instances that you are keeping those gigabytes right here, okay? Any junk material, still delete it. Free the memory space. Any material you think that is not going to help you or is not that standard, delete it. Sodium, major extracellular cation. Sodium is a cation, intracellular or extracellular? Sodium.
Extracellular.
Okay, we don't need it now. Inshallah. Attracts fluid and helps to preserve fluid volume. Okay. Combines with chloride and bicarbonate to help to regulate acid-base balance. Normal sodium range is 135 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. Milliequivalents per liter. If sodium is suddenly increased, extracellular fluid concentration also rises. Like if somebody takes 2 teaspoons of salt, what happens then?
High osmolarity,
what would happen next?
Thirsty.
You will feel thirsty. What you will then take?
Water.
That is what Mackie is using. All the fries are high salt or low salt?
High salt.
That has been intentionally done. By the time you complete your meal, you feel like having that cola. That is the business strategy using physiology. Okay? That I sell the fries for 8 riyals, I also want to sell this cola for 4 riyals, so it should be 12 riyals. Okay, that is the idea. So this value that you have to remember, increased serum sodium increases thirst and causes release of
ADH.
Because ADH deals with water and salt or only free water?
Free water.
This triggers kidneys to retain water only, no more salt. Aldosterone has also a function in water and sodium conservation. Once sodium levels are low, aldosterone would be good, but the thing requirement is sodium level should be low. Normal sodium level or high sodium level, aldosterone is of no help. Having said this, the percentage, this is a nephron that is being shown, the proximal tubule, the ascending loop, the distal convoluted tubule, most of the sodium is absorbed from which part of nephron? Maximum.
Proximal.
PCT is the best answer. Okay? Proximal. PCT is the best answer. Proximal tubule, you would absorb maximum, around 70%. Then ascending in the loop, you would be absorbing maybe another 20%, okay? And by then, in the distal convoluted, maybe only 5% remaining. Distal convoluted and collecting tubule, maybe 2 to 3%. 2 to 3% only. But that 3% is indeed very important for us once we talk of ADH. So, having said this, the regulated variable, whenever there is the extracellular fluid volume, this would be, whenever it is going, it is disturbed, there are sensors called as cardiovascular stress sensors, and the effector would be kidney GFR, aldosterone, the natriuretic hormone, the sympathetic nerve, all this would cause renal sodium excretion. So this is related to, the sodium is related to two things. Is it related to volume?
Yes.
Sodium? Yes. And is it related to osmolarity?
Yes.
Yes. Both. Sodium is important for both. Coming to hypernatremia. Hypernatremia would happen. I start losing free water, like sweating. I'm losing all the water, ma fi salt. What happens to my salt concentration in my blood? Increase. So any case in which I'm losing free water, like sweating, like burns, in fever, pneumonia. Pneumonia, why there is pneumonia, I would land up in hypertension, anybody?
Because
pneumonia.
The lung has...
the lung has what?
The enzyme.
Enzyme? No enzyme business, huh?
Alkalosis,
no pH change. No pH change. Once we breathe in and breathe out, while we walk down, we breathe in dry air.
Alkalosis.
No alkalosis. We breathe in dry air,
We
moisturize it with our water vapors, and we breathe out the moisturized air. So do we lose water?
Yes,
we lose kathir amount of water in dry weather once the sun is there at 50 degrees centigrade. We lose kathir amount of water, but still on an average, 150 to 200 milli of water is lost by the ventilation. In pneumonia, it is fast ventilation or slow ventilation? High ventilation. That's why in pneumonia also, once you lose free water molecules outside, the plasma remaining would become concentrated or dilute. Concentrated. So that is a case of high sodium, hypernatremia. Also diarrhea and diuretic. So losses from skin, urine, GI loss, all this can cause hypernatremia. There is a special case called as diabetes insipidus. What is the meaning of diabetes? Diabetes, yeah.
Low ADH and polyuria and polydipsia.
Diabetes insipidus would be low ADH and yes, correct, and more of diabetes insipidus, diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus and diabetes insipidus. Diabetes mellitus is about insulin. Diabetes insipidus is about ADH deficiency. Mellitus is insulin deficiency. Insipidus is ADH deficiency. Okay, so diabetes, very recently I came to know just by watching one of the tutors like telling about what a diabetes means. Diabetes means a fountain. Okay, a fountain. That means whenever a nafar is having diabetes insipidus, okay, he would be producing a fountain of urine, kathir amount of urine. There is no ADH, so will he absorb water?
No.
There is no ADH, so will he absorb taking water from the nephron?
No.
There is no ADH, so will it absorb water from the filtrate?
No.
So the urine pass would be more or less?
More.
The urine pass would be more. And it is insipid. Insipid means tasteless. Okay? So diabetes insipidus is once you are losing only free water. ADH deals with water, you are losing free water. If you are losing free water, you are not getting that free water into your circulation. If you are not bringing free water into the circulation becomes concentrated or dilute?
Concentrated,
that means high sodium. That is the case of high sodium. Diabetes insipidus, you have high urinary volume. As the ism says, diabetes means fountain of urine, okay? High urinary volume loss. Insufficient ADH, less of ADH is there. And the symptom they would present as hypernatremia, the symptom they would present as confusion, disorientation, lethargy, seizure. All these are symptoms of which system?
CNS system.
Central nervous system. Sodium, CNS. Sodium, CNS. Sodium would affect your CNS mainly. Okay? Will potassium affect the CNS? Potassium can affect CNS? Yes or no?
Yes.
To bring symptoms like confusion, disorientation, lethargy? So potassium, I'm asking potassium. Sodium would do it. Sodium is doing it. Potassium, can it do confusion because of low potassium or high potassium, anything, something like this way?
No. Yes. We'll do opposite.
So it cannot, potassium cannot do it because The nafar would already die of those levels because of cardiac arrhythmia.
Yes.
He won't get a chance to bring that potassium to that kathir level to bring a CNS symptom. Shall I repeat it?
Yes.
Potassium will not rise. Potassium, as it is say, for instance, potassium is rising. The nafar would have arrhythmia, and if still the potassium is rising, the nafar would have arrhythmia and he would die.
Before
you bring a symptom of CNS of kathir potassium. That is the idea. That's why you do not in clinical scenario get a CNS feature with high potassium because of high potassium. Sodium, yes, sodium is related to CNS, so high sodium is going to give you confusion, disorientation, lethargy and seizure. If uncorrected, severe hypernatremia can cause even coma or irreversible brain damage. Sodium disorders cause CNS problem. This is what you have to remember. Sodium and CNS. That is what you should speak up loud in front of mirror once or twice so that it is there in your head. Diabetes insipidus. The mushkila in diabetes insipidus is low ADH. It can be two things. ADH comes from? ADH comes from posterior or anterior pituitary? Posterior. And is coming from hypothalamus, true. So I can have a problem with my central mushkila with my hypothalamus and pituitary, I'm not producing ADH. Or I'm producing ADH, but this ADH is working right here. My kidney tubules are resistant to ADH. I repeat, I'm not making ADH at the central level, maybe hypothalamus and pituitary. That can be one of the problem, or I am making ADH, but this ADH coming to the collecting tubule cells, my collecting tubule cells are resistant to action of ADH. Okay, so one of this is called as central diabetes insipidus. The problem is where? The hypothalamus and the pituitary. One is the nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Where is the mushkila?
In the
kidney tubules. Okay. ADH level, if you measure ADH level in blood, the central, the nephrogenic. You take my blood and measure the ADH level.
Nephrogenic
would be normal or high. Normal or high. The central would be
deficient.
Okay. So there are causes for this central diabetes insipidus, there are causes for nephrogenic, there are not many drugs you can see, lithium is one of them, okay. Central diabetes insipidus is mainly CNS disorder, anything in CNS can cause central diabetes insipidus, okay. Understandable if somebody has a stroke and is affecting hypothalamus, possible. Somebody has a tumor pressing on hypothalamus or pituitary, possible. Trauma to hypothalamus and pituitary, possible. Hypoxia to brain, hypothalamus and pituitary, possible. Infection of brain, hypothalamus affected, pituitary affected, possible. So central is possible because of all the CNS disorder. The nephrogenic would be something that is drugs, maybe lithium, dimethylcycline, or chronic disease or kidney disease. All these can cause, the major is the drug. The major is the drug that can cause nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Diabetes insipidus is less action or absence of ADH. Hypernatremia diagnostic test to distinguish between diabetes insipidus from other causes of hypernatremia, what you have to look is look for the increased urine volume. Look for the increased urine volume. Look for the decreased urine osmolality and look for the decreased urine sodium. What they mean to say in this is what they happen to say into this stuff is that whenever you have increase in urine volume, okay? So whenever you have a urinary sodium and this is the volume, whenever you have a normal sodium and you are producing a normal volume, as you are losing the sodium, you would be coming down in volume. If you are running low on sodium, you would be producing more urine or less urine?
Yes.
Low of sodium, you will be producing less of urine.
Yes.
Okay. If you are having low plasma sodium, you will be producing less of urine. Plasma sodium. Okay. So plasma sodium was normal, you were producing normal urine, but as the plasma sodium is coming down, you will be producing less of urine. Because the process of urine formation, the filtration, all those, you see a lot of sodium is getting lost. Okay. So, majority is carb, but ideal should be one third, that is how it should be. Okay. I can increase a bit of protein and carb and decrease the fat sum. That is the ideal. So you take up majority of carb and protein and fat, but finally in the body the carb is only 1%. That means most of the carb are used. Nothing is stored, not more than 1% is stored. That is the idea. The maximum is the water, that is around 60% for males and 50% for females. Because females have got more of the fatty tissues and less of the lean body mass. More of the fatty tissues and less of lean body mass, that's why there is a variation. So this is one idea that you should be getting. Nucleic acid, again 2%. This whole of the body water, we are having so much of body water, that is around 60%, is divided into the intracellular, the extracellular compartment. And that's why we follow a rule called the 60-40-20 rule. This is according to the body weight. This is according to the body weight. Okay? Normally for all calculation purpose, we take this. Unless and until it is specified in the question that you have to take, like for a female, you have to take 50% or something that way. Otherwise, we go with this formula. If I happen to look that there is a sumo wrestler who is 100 kilograms, okay? So how much water is there in the body?
60.
60 kilograms or 60 liters?
60.
Okay, so again, that is a controversy. In medical science and in such calculations, we take it as a liter and a kilogram as same. Is it exactly the same?
No.
No, it is not. There is a minor variation. But we nullify, we don't look to the variation, we take it as same. So body weight is 100 kilograms. Definitely my water would be in liters. So I would consider it as 60 liters. Most of this water, 60 liters is the kullu water in the body, is divided into two compartments, inside the cell and outside the cell. Which one is more, inside the cell or outside the cell?
Inside
the cell, that is again 40%. 40% of the body weight, okay? Outside the cell is only 20% of the body weight. Outside the cell, what are the fluids that are outside the cell?
Plasma
is in vessels. Okay, anything more?
Interstitial
fluid is mafi mojood in vessels. It is mojood in between the gaps and the tissues. That's why it is called as tissue fluids also. Interstitial fluid, tissue fluids are same. Okay, so plasma and the interstitial fluid. Which one is more? Is it the plasma that is more or interstitial fluid is more?
Interstitial
fluid.
Plasma is a catch. Plasma is the best wrong answer. Because we can say, think of a circulatory system as a blood, plasma, that's why I think plasma is more. It is the interstitial fluid that is more. It is around 15% of the body weight. Plasma has only 5% of the body weight. Okay? So 5% and 50% kullu jama 20%. 20% is extracellular fluid. 20% of body weight. That is one thing that you have to catch in this slide. 20% of body weight. Okay? Blood. How much is blood?
6 liters.
5.
I mean, blood. Plasma is 5% of body weight. Plasma plus cells is blood. So blood is 8% of body weight. Okay, blood is 8% of body weight. From the body weight, I can calculate how much like blood would be. Okay, so this is the idea. You can get some questions into that, how this has to be distributed up. Maybe the font size is too small. We should have. Anyways, total body water, intracellular is kathir, you see right here, intracellular. Extracellular is less, this is 60%, this is 40%, this is 20%, this whole of the stuff is 60% body weight, total body water. Out of this, according to body weight, it is 40% intracellular and 20% extracellular. Out of extracellular, 15% is interstitial and 5% is your plasma. Between the interstitial, this is the plasma module in the blood vessel. Is this interacting with the interstitial fluid?
Yes.
And is this interstitial fluid interacting with the cellular fluid, intracellular fluid?
Maybe some exchanging, yes.
I'm going to say, you make a change in the plasma. Bathing sometime, will this change affect the interstitial fluid concentration?
Yes.
And can this affect the intracellular concentration?
Yes.
So that is the idea behind it. Having said this, the same diagram has been shown up. Total body water is 60% of the body weight, is divided into 40 and 20. Further, this extracellular is divided into interstitial and plasma. We have not mentioned here. We have not mentioned here another group of division of fluids that is maybe majood as cerebrospinal fluid, that may be majood as aqueous fluid in our eyes, that we may be majood as vitreous fluid in our eyes. We have exempted it. Why? We have not taken into consideration right here. Why? Because those are the fluids that are not affected in homeostasis by quick changes. You change the sodium concentration of the plasma, it would affect the sodium concentration of interstitial fluid, it can affect the sodium concentration of the cells, but it is not going to change the sodium concentration of the aqueous humor very early. Okay? That's why we have not considered those fluids, right?
Yeah.
Fluid in the knee joints. Which fluid?
Synovium.
Synovium. We have not considered right here. Okay? That would sum up, it would make maybe Vahid percent or something total, less than a Vahid percent. That's why we have not summated it right here. Okay? Yeah.
Cerebrospinal fluid cannot be affected by any circulatory changes.
It can be affected, it is in interaction, but not that quick because you already have a
blood-brain barrier.
Having said this, physiological variation in total body water, physiological variation is according to age, according to sex, and according to the fat content. So what you see right here, total body water for the male would be 60% of the body weight, 50% for the females. For the old man, it is only 50%, and for babies, newborn, it is 70% of the body weight. Maximum total body water is with man, woman, old person, or the baby?
The
newborn. So people who would be further expertizing or becoming postgraduates in pediatrics, then they would come to know the importance of this total body water that is so high in babies. Okay, yes, there was some question.
Yes, fat. The more fat, more water.
The more fat, the less the water. Okay? The more fat, the less the water, because you have lean body mass less. Fat is water loving or water repelling? So more of fat, less of water.
Is there a major difference between neonates, children and infants?
No.
In water content?
Water content, definitely these would be high, but just as taking as the infant and neonates, it is 70% around. So if like there is some MCQs or there is some question testing that a total body water is maximum in which of the these following. So not the old age and not the middle ages. Okay, it is towards the newborns, the infants, the neonate, whichever is the option, that is the best option. Having said this, we move further up to movement of water between the body compartments. We know there are various methods by which body water moves, be it osmosis, be it diffusion, be it filtration. Okay, there is some difference. Osmosis is movement of water, diffusion is movement of salt. Filtration is movement of maybe both, water and salt both, filtration, okay, water and salt both. So to understand this, these processes, okay, right here we shall show you with a, maybe a diagram would be helpful. What you see right here is we have taken two of the fluids in beaker A and beaker B. Okay. Obviously, these are solutions, two different solutions. What do you see right here? These are the solute molecules. These are the solute or the salt molecules. Yep. And these are the salt molecules here. Where are the solutes more? In which solution the solutes are more? A or B?
B.
Solution B has more of solutes. Solution B has more of solutes. Yep. Which one would have more of water?
B.
Equal. I've kept the solution equal quantity. Has a 5 ml, has a 5 ml?
Same.
This has got more of solute. Which will have more of water?
A.
The solution is the same.
No. And the concentration is, you see, the concentration depends. Concentration, okay, let's, okay, so you need, I was expecting that you were clear with this. Fine. So we go with the upside down, okay? Solution is a mixture of solutes and solvent. Everybody agrees? A solute and a solvent. A salt and a water, correct? Now, concentration is given, depends upon water or solute. General talking, concentration is talked about amount of solute, okay? And that is given by which unit? Osmolarity. Osmolarity. Concentration of a solution is given by osmolarity. That's why we have written osmolarity is directly proportional to the solute concentration. Which one has a higher concentration of solute, A or B?
B.
Which one has a higher osmolarity, A or B?
B.
Till here, any doubt? Fine. So we will bring some doubt for you. Which one has more of water, guys?
A.
Which one has more of water?
A.
Same.
Same? No,
same.
It is
same.
5 ml hina, 5 ml hina. Solution, amount of solution is the same. If the solute is more hina, lazim water would be?
Less.
If solute is less hina, lazim water would be?
More.
Make this correction, everybody. Everybody got it? Now, anything moves, be it water or solute, moves from high concentration to low concentration. In case of diffusion, what moves? Water or solute?
Yes.
Solute moves. In case of osmosis, what moves?
Water.
So in case of osmosis, if I have to move the water, water moves from A to B or B to A?
A to B.
A to B.
A to B.
A to B.
A to B. Water will move from B to A.
Water would move from?
B to B.
Anything moves from high concentration to low concentration?
From B.
Water kati where? In A or B?
A.
So in osmosis, water would move from A to B. Remember that. Water would move from A to B. I'm not asking the salt where it is going to move. No matter this has got high osmolarity, no matter this has got more of salt. But if I'm talking of Wahid osmosis, water would move from A to B. This was the catch.
Simple diffusion of water.
But osmosis is a special ism only for water. Okay? Diffusion can be of particles, like if I put a good deodorant, the particles are moving. I put some salt solution, the salt is moving. Particles. Okay? Is this concept clear with you?
Yes.
Fine. Osmolarity depends upon solute concentration. Okay? If once I say osmolarity of my solution is kabir, okay? Osmolarity of solution is kabir, that means water is
less.
Keep that thing in mind. So just as an example right here of our tea bag. Right here what you see is diffusion of particles. Once you put the tea bag, some amount of coffee or tea also comes out. This is by diffusion. But once you put the tea bag in the hot water, does some water get inside?
Sure.
Yes.
Yes, water gets inside. Where was the solute more? In the tea bag or in the cup?
Tea bag.
Okay, once you put the tea bag, some of the solutes come out from tea bag into water from high concentration to low concentration. That was diffusion. A special case of water diffusion is called as osmosis. Water was where kabir? In the cup or in the tea bag?
Cup.
So once I put the tea bag, water would get into the tea bag by osmosis. By osmosis. Filtration is about moving of both solute and water according to their concentration. Filtration. So, if you have survived this, then volume of fluid compartment depends upon amount of solute. Amount of solute it contains. So, osmolarity is the concentration of osmotically active particles or solute expressed as millimoles. Expressed as millimoles. Like, say for instance, this is the barrier line. Yep. So many solutes are there, not student solutes are there. This is one compartment, this is the other compartment. You see a white solute standing in. That means, if you allow the transfer of water, all the water would start moving from my side to your side. It would keep on moving, so that there comes a equilibrium or a balance. So the volume would be decided, the amount of water that you take would be decided by how much solute you are having. That's what it says. Volume of a compartment depends upon amount of solute. More the amount of solute would be there, more of water would keep on moving and make that compartment larger before it comes to equilibrium and stops. Okay? This amount of solute is given by osmolarity, and osmolarity and osmolality, there is a mild difference. It is calculating the osmotically active particles per liter, and here it is calculating osmotically active particles per kilogram. Generally, you can use both of them and it means the same. Plasma osmolarity. In plasma, you know, there are kathir amount of sodium, there is glucose, there is blood urea nitrogen. All these are solutes. And this would decide what is the concentration of solute in plasma. This would decide what is the osmolarity of plasma. In normal situations, the glucose and the blood urea nitrogen is within normal range, and if you sum up, they contribute very little, maybe only 10. So plasma osmolarity mainly depends upon plasma sodium. 2 times the plasma sodium plus 10 if glucose and blood urea nitrogen is normal. Will somebody tell me how much is the normal plasma osmolarity? How much is the normal plasma osmolarity?
180.
Add 100 to it, add, so it becomes 285 plus minus 10 milliosmoles per liter. Out of this 285, how much is contributed by glucose and blood urea nitrogen?
10%.
Not 10%, only
10.
And 275 is coming from
sodium.
That's why sodium is so very important to define osmolarity in body fluids. That's why sodium is so very important to define the osmolarity of the body fluids. It is of par importance. That's why plasma osmolarity in normal situations, it is the sodium that is governing it. 2 times the sodium plus 10, it should come out to be 285. For practical purpose, some people are very bad with mathematics, so they remember it as, maybe some people to be accurate, it should be 290, but generalizing it, they ask as 300. Okay? But 285 is a good figure to remember. So water was majood in the body in which two compartments? Extracellular and intracellular. Was there some ions and solutes also majood in these extracellular and intracellular? And that would decide what would be the osmolarity of these spaces, and finally they would come into equilibrium so that all the cells are in equilibrium with my, all the blood cell majood hena is in equilibrium with my plasma. Sahib, all this plasma is in equilibrium with the interstitial fluid, and all the interstitial fluid is in equilibrium with the intracellular fluid. What is the osmolarity of roughly, approximately, on an average, what is the osmolarity of interstitial fluid? If the osmolarity of plasma is 285, it would be same. That is what people don't get it. It will be same. What would be the osmolarity of the cytoplasm of the cell, roughly?
280.
Should be same again. Did you get this concept okay? Plasma osmolarity would be same as the interstitial, would be same as the intracellular. That's the reason why you are given a quiz. You are given a quiz that you come with a jar in which there is a hypertonic solution. Hypertonic to what? Hypertonic to plasma. Hypertonic to plasma. That means having more osmolarity than plasma. Then you pick up a cell from the body and put it inside this beaker. A high osmolarity solution. You take a cell and put it into the beaker. What will happen to the cell?
Shrink.
What would happen? A cell would shrink. Cell would shrink because there is kathir osmolarity hena, so all the water would come out. It would shrink. So that is the idea: osmolarity of plasma, osmolarity of interstitial fluid, and osmolarity inside the cell is kind, some kind of equilibrium that comes around 285. Having said this, out of this, which is the which osmolarity is easy to change?
Plasma.
Plasma is the easiest. You drink 2 liters of acid, you dilute your plasma. If it is not taken care, somebody drinks 2 liters of acid and he dilutes his plasma, and if it is not taken care, and he sleeps at night, by morning what would happen? Will all these values change?
Yes, yes.
All these values change. That's the reason why your kidneys, your hypothalamus, ADH, all this starts working quickly to remove that 2 liters of acid that you extra taken. So whichever night you have partied long with 2 liters of acid, that is the night you will be peeing more. Obviously, you have to pass those 2 liters outside. The balance has to be maintained. Get 2 liters, pass on 2 liters. If you don't do this, you say, oh no, Dr. Saif, I will just each day, I will start keeping only 1 milli of fluid in me. You keep 1 milli of fluid a la tool every day, again you will make a complete change. You cannot do that. The balance is perfect. Input is equal to output. So did you get this concept of osmolarity right? Fine. Having said this, and we have got this right, this formula has to be remembered, guys. Okay? Because now they are testing for, they are not testing for normal. They are not testing for normal. A diabetic person comes with a blood sugar of 320, plasma blood sugar is 320, okay, his blood and rest of the parameters are normal. Can you calculate the plasma osmolarity?
No.
You can calculate, and say 140 is your, around sodium is around 140, 145, okay. So plasma sodium multiplied by 2, this would come out to be 145. You double it, how much it comes out to be? 290. Okay, 290. 290 is for sodium, and then you have glucose. Glucose is not normal. Glucose is, they are saying 320. So glucose 320 divided by 80. Now let's say 180 glucose. 180 glucose is also not normal if it is a fasting glucose. Okay, or let's make it 360. 360 glucose. 360 is the glucose. So how much it would come? 80 into 20. So it would sum up to be 20. Okay, so you have to calculate for glucose, because in the question they have given a diabetic nephr with an abnormal glucose. This formula holds good only once the nephr is Maffei diabetic and Maffei in renal failure. Clear? This formula holds good, 2 times plasma plus 10, only if the nephr is not diabetic and the nephr is not in some kind of renal failure. That means there is no derangement of glucose and there is no derangement of blood urea nitrogen. Plasma osmolarity should be same as, extracellular osmolarity should be same as intracellular osmolarity. And osmolarity defines how big the compartment will be. How big the compartment will be. To understand the events in the distribution of the water, first what you have to see is, first identify any of the change in extracellular fluid. There are a lot many disturbances going with the osmolarity, okay, in the plasma. First you have to identify what is the change that has been done. Was the solute added to extracellular fluid or the water was lost from extracellular fluid? That is first you have to decide. Second thing you will be doing is decide what that change will produce, an increase or decrease or no change in the osmolarity. What would happen to the osmolarity? What was the change? What happened to the osmolarity? Third thing you will decide, if there is a change in ECF osmolarity, whether the water would shift into the cell or out of cell. Into the cell or out of cell. So these are the three things that you have to answer before deciding that any change would cause, how it would affect the water balance in the body. How it will affect the water balance in the body. This will be more clear. So we are sorry for this.
same?
Fine. So come back to our right here. The same diagram. Water compartment is divided into intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid. This is the whole of the water compartment of our body. We know that on this axis there is a volume. This is the volume of the water compartment. This much is has a intracellular and this much is has a extracellular. On this axis is volume. What is there in this axis?
Osmolarity.
Osmolarity. Volume hina, osmolarity hina. Correct? This is the normal diagram that we have this amount of intracellular and this amount of extracellular with a osmolarity of how much?
Same.
How much it is? 285.
285.
Normal osmolarity 285. Correct? This is how the osmolarity would increase. And this is how the volume would increase. Is this chart okay with you? And what do you see? We were not wrong. Intracellular osmolarity and extracellular osmolarity is
same.
And in the extracellular osmolarity, we have not shown you hina plasma. Plasma is included.
Yeah.
Plasma in interstitial fluid, it is included. Not to complicate the diagram, we have just kept as in extracellular and intracellular. Correct?
Yes.
Fine. There is a change, there is a stimulus in the body that has done this. Has the volume shrinked up, changed, has decreased, has the volume decreased?
Yes.
This was the normal one, the bold line.
Yes.
The dotted one is the change. Has the volume changed?
Yes.
Okay, has the volume changed? Has the osmolarity changed?
No.
No, kind of same. Kind of same. Osmolarity is same. Just to make you appreciate, I have drawn a separate, otherwise it is. In the diagram, it is on the same line. Okay? Has the osmolarity changed?
No.
No. Is it possible any change in body that would do this?
No.
Yes, it is possible that anybody who is having diarrhea, anybody who is having diarrhea, is throwing away the body water and the body salt in same concentration that is modulated in the plasma. In the same concentration, somebody is having diarrhea, okay? Somebody is having diarrhea, so definitely the concentration of the fluid loss, the fluid that is going in diarrhea is same osmolarity 285. So you would be losing the volume, but will you be changing the osmolarity?
No.
No. You'll be losing the volume, but you won't be changing the osmolarity.
No.
Because the osmolarity of the fluid that is getting lost is the same as what was modulated. There was no increase in salt or decrease in salt.
Let us.
I was checking that we are going for volume contraction of all the contraction will take force and then the expansion. So, right here. What is the change?
Osmolarity.
The osmolarity has increased or decreased?
Increased.
Increased. What has happened to the volume?
Decreased.
The volume has?
Decreased.
Decreased. The volume has shrunk up. The volume has decreased and osmolarity has increased. This would be in a case, in all cases, where you are losing more of water and less of salt.
Yes.
You are losing more of water and less of
salt.
If you are losing more of water is getting lost from extracellular, for instance, okay? What would happen to the extracellular fluid? You are losing only water, pure water. What would happen to the osmolarity of extracellular fluid?
Increase.
Increase. and the volume would
decrease.
But then it would come in equilibrium with the intracellular fluid. So what would happen to the intracellular fluid?
Decrease
the volume and increase the osmolarity. This type of picture would come like in excessive sweating, like in once you are losing only free water. Okay? Yeah, come again.
Diabetes?
Diabetes insipidus also can go with this. You would be just losing only pure water and you would start increasing the osmolarity. Okay? So the chart that we wanted to draw and show you are these. What would be the diagram if I want to infuse a saline that is isotonic? Saline that is isotonic.
I would increase the volume.
You would increase the
hypertonic
isotonic saline. I mean, so you put a cannula and you start giving a 1 liter saline. You have given 1 liter of saline. This is the normal. You have given 1 liter of saline, what would happen? Saline is isotonic, same osmolarity as our plasma. So, will you do this? Will this bit happen, guys?
Yes.
You have increased the volume by putting saline right here. Did you change the osmolarity?
No.
You did not change the osmolarity. You did not change the osmolarity.
Isotonic will change.
Isotonic, osmolarity is same as the plasma. You are just putting some extra fluid here. So it would change the volume, tayab, but you have not put extra salt. It was the same salt concentration in the plasma and same salt concentration in the saline. So will it change the osmolarity?
No.
Initially we talked about volume contraction, like sweating, like diarrhea, previous cases. Now we are talking of volume expansion.
That's it.
Volume expansion.
Can we say changing in the volume doesn't change the osmolarity?
Depends upon what type of change in the volume. Like if you give a hypertonic saline. Hypertonic saline is concentrated saline. Will not change the volume. Lazim will change the volume. You give half liter of saline, lazim it would change the volume. So it would change the volume and it would change the osmolarity. So it would grow up in volume and also it would grow up in osmolarity. What would happen next? Hypertonic solution. Hypertonic. The second graph, it would go up if it is a hypertonic one. So having said this, what would happen if you only take that's what sodium or salt or hypertonic solution, it comes up to be the same. SIADH, we'll talk about SIADH and adrenal insufficiency later on. Diabetes insipidus, somebody talked about diabetes insipidus? Diabetes insipidus?
Yes.
What was the case for diabetes insipidus?
No,
both the volumes decreased and the osmolarity
has increased.
That was SIADH. Both the volumes have decreased and the osmolarity has increased. If you make it this way, this way and this way. This is the case of diabetes insipidus. The volume has decreased, both the volumes, and the osmolarity has increased. This would be also in case of if you are losing free water, like in excessive sweating. I'm just losing white water, I'm not losing salt. If I'm losing water, will the volume shrink?
Yes.
Okay. What would happen to the osmolarity or the concentration of the salt in it? am losing only water.
Increase.
Losing water.
Losing water.
Loss of pure water. You are losing water, so definitely volume comes down. But if you lose water, what happens to plasma? Does it becomes dilute or does it becomes concentrated? It becomes concentrated. If you lose water, it becomes concentrated. That's why the osmolarity goes up. But then sometime it would equilibrate with the intracellular fluid. So what change it would bring? The same. The same change would be brought. This would decrease in volume and its concentration would go up. This picture is after equilibrium is done. These pictures are after equilibrium is completed. Is it okay, people? So if you get such type of questions and say what is increasing or what is decreasing, that is what you have to take care into.
Whenever the volume decreases, the osmolarity will increase.
Whenever the volume
decrease,
the osmolarity would increase. No. Whenever the volume would decrease, the osmolarity would increase. No, not necessarily.
Sometimes they go
clearly,
yes,
it will
be the same.
Yes, come again.
I think Jitan, what he's trying to say, no, concentration would increase because, like,
come. Intracellular fluid. Other extracellular fluid. Yes, Nafar. We lost, somebody met with an accident, he lost half liter of blood, half liter of plasma. His volume becomes?
Decrease.
Concentration would go up or same?
No,
same. Concentration would be same. Bleeding, hemorrhage, acute hemorrhage bleeding, this would happen. You have lost the volume, but there is no change in concentration. Concentration remains the same. You want to correct this volume loss, because if you do not correct this volume loss, there is intracellular. There is also loss of intracellular volume. That means all the cells would start shrinking a bit. You do not want that. You do not want intracellular dehydration, because lot of enzymes would be compromised. Lot of metabolic processes would be compromised. That's why any nafar who bleeds, that's why any nafar who is having diarrhea, throwing away the same concentration of fluid outside, okay, they have to be given quickly the volume replacement. If you do not give the volume replacement, it would cause intracellular dehydration. Is it okay?
This hemorrhage, there will be increase, absorb this new saline. Osmolarity should be reduced.
No, first hemorrhage, you have lost half liter blood.
After that, with equilibrium, the osmolarity will be reduced.
Why? I lose half liter of blood, I have lost the same plasma that is flowing.
Yeah.
Yep. So if I lose the plasma outside, how is it going to change the...
And then you drink a pure water.
No, not drinking, that is remedial. Now what you drink or what you, that is the management part. Right now I'm asking you, what is the physiological thing that happened by the hemorrhage? The physiological thing happened this. Okay? How will you correct it? Will you give a normal saline, a saline that is same in osmolarity? Will you give a hypertonic saline or will you give a hypotonic saline?
Normal saline.
Isotonic, because all you want to correct is just the
volume.
Just the volume. What you would give, Hina?
Hypo.
You want to correct the volume. Volume can be corrected by any, a concentrated solution, really 5 spoons of salt, or just a wahid glass of water. A wahid glass of water with 5 spoons of salt, or just a wahid glass of water. Only a glass of water can bring up the volume and would try to bring the concentration down. So that what you are asking is management part. Right now we are asking you, this was the problem, what effect will it have in the body?
Yes.
Okay?
Yes,
please.
When we do the hypotonic?
When we do the?
Give hypotonic.
Hypotonic?
Yeah.
Once you have lost any salt, Kathir amount of aldosterone is produced in? Cushing's, corns, okay? All these Kathir amount of aldosterone. Aldosterone has got salt business or water business?
Salt.
ADH has?
Water.
Only water business. Aldosterone has salt and water both business.
Yes.
So it would throw away water, it would throw away salt. For to correct that, you have to give a saline that is rich in salt. Okay.
Why we don't give the normal saline? Because he lost the boat.
He lost the boat, but he has lost it extremely. Normal saline, if you give a normal saline, okay, it would bring the concentration, it would increase the concentration, but it would take Kathir amount of normal saline to be put in. Okay? You do not put up 10 liters of saline in me. My kullu circulating volume is only 5 liters. Are you getting that? So, if I've lost only a wahid liter of blood or anything, you have to compensate that wahid liter, and you have to compensate in such a manner that you do not disturb my osmolarity. That is the idea. So, just go back and go through it. This is an important zone that year 3 should be knowing it.
Doctor,
sorry for yeah.
The osmolarity of the blood is question.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll
the osmolarity of the blood will be opposite to osmolarity of the urine.
Osmolarity of the blood would be opposite to osmolarity
urine.
Of the urine. No. Normally, if I have low sodium in my body, I have low cash in my Al-Raji. Will I start distributing cash?
No.
No. I have low sodium in my body. I cannot throw away extra sodium in my urine. I will try to conserve it. Getting the idea? We'll cover up that in the coming slides. I hope so. No teacher is waiting for you people outside. Okay, just there is a recommendation that we'll cover up if any doubt or queries. So this was one of the important slides that you must be knowing. Principle of balance, water intake should be equal to water output. Salt intake should be equal to salt excretion. Okay, the same nafar is standing for ages. Daily input of water 2700 milli, daily output of water again 2700 milli. Output is balanced by input, not much into this. Fluid electrolyte hemostasis, all organism maintains a hemostasis because I want to keep this extracellular hemostasis maintained, because this is the one that can be easily disturbed. And when this is disturbed, interstitial and then intracellular can be disturbed if this is not corrected. That's why body has lot many mechanisms to correct it. I am not drinking water since morning. Okay, so my plasma osmolarity is rising. My thirst center would be stimulated and I would want to drink water. My kidneys would be starting conserving the water. That's what happened in Ramadan days. So, extracellular hemostasis would try to maintain the extracellular fluid composition, volume, osmolarity and pH at a normal level. I do not want to change, just see this. I do not want to change the osmolarity, I do not want to change the volume, I do not want to change the composition. I want to maintain it as it is. Kidneys, they have a big role in maintaining this extracellular hemostasis. Thirst, again it has a big role in maintaining the extracellular hemostasis. Renal physiology, coming to kidneys, we have talked about kidneys, the one thing that has got relation to maintaining the extracellular hemostasis. So for kidneys, what you happen to look right here, this is a nephron around, okay, and this is the feeding capillary. This is the afferent arteriole, blood comes in, gets filtered up, and this is the efferent arteriole that is going downwards, Can anybody tell that what is happening right here, what is the process? This is the process. filtration. This is the filtrate. The fluid maujood hina is called as filtrate. It has filtered out from plasma. The filtrate would never be having one stuff that is maujood in plasma. What is that?
Protein.
Which protein?
Albumin.
Albumin is the right answer. Okay. Large size protein, albumin. You will never have a protein albumin right here. Okay, you can have all the potassium, sodium, calcium, magnesium, glucose, all of this stuff. But you would never